Hello everyone, at last we have the new Kron Sega episode. Just like last time, we'll be covering a few Mega Drive and Genesis games that were released between June and November 1989, as well as a few Master System games which appeared to have been released sometime around fall 1989. Now I assume that many of you are familiar with Greg Stewart's Generation 16 series, and might be thinking, hey, you guys are not doing the games in the same order, what's up with that? Well, you'd be right. Generation 16 is doing these games mostly in order of Japanese release, whereas I am trying to do them in the order that they were first released, regardless of which country. And a few of the games today actually came out in the US before they did in Japan. So, for example, he did Revenge of Shinobi at a much later place than I did. I'll just put in another reminder that if you're not already checking out Generation 16, you should, and also Jeremy Parrish's Game Boy World, which is covering the Nintendo Game Boy, something that a lot of you had asked me to do, and I am not doing that, but Parrish is. Also, as mentioned earlier, my new channel is up, Dr. Sparkle After Dark. You can see the link a bit further down on my YouTube channel page. The first video will be posted pretty shortly, so keep an eye out for that. Okay, let's get started. We kick off July 1989 with one of two titles released that month. This is the second game from the Mega Drive based on a licensed property, the first of course being that goofy Oso Matsu-kun game from 1988. Yep, this is yet another Hokuto no Ken game, that is, Fist of the North Star. It's the fourth such game we've covered so far in the various Kron series. The full title translates to New Legend of the End of the Century Savior. This incredibly long text scroll gives some backstory here. Now, Fist of the North Star apparently has some kind of incredibly complicated plot about a post-World War III society in which a guy saves the world by punching people so hard they explode. In fact, this game is so macho and action-packed that the push start button actually explodes itself. This received a US release very quickly, without the Fist of the North Star licensed, under the new name Last Battle in August 1989, and as we can see, the story still revolves around a savior in a post-apocalyptic world. The protagonist has been renamed Arzak, and there's someone named Alyssa, and there's also his brother, Gross, and Garruk, and geez, slow down. I really can't quite take all this in. I guess they just don't give a shit whether you understand the plot or not. Though what I'm wondering is why did they rename Kenshiro character as Arzak, apparently after the famous Mobius creation, that, you know, that dude with the pointy hat. This is the second Sega-created Fist of the North Star game. The first was, of course, the Master System game that came out almost exactly 3 years prior. In the US was called Black Belt and had that famously awful box cover. So what we have here will definitely not come as a surprise if you remember the earlier Fist of the North Star games we've seen. This is a very simple repetitive beat-em-up in which you walk forward and either punch or kick a never-ending series of guys who either come running at you or jump at you. Some guys attack you with their little axes. Other dudes will want to poke you with spears, and some of them just sort of stand up there on the roads and wait for you to jump up and kill them. It's pretty exciting. At the end of the level, you will usually meet another character and exchange one or two lines of dialogue. Oh yeah, this guy has the look of a hero, alright. Must be the pink hair. Now here's where things get exciting. Last Battle draws you into the exciting world of interactive entertainment by letting you choose which path you take around the world. 95% of the locations on the maps are just standard beat-em-up sequences like we just saw, but there are boss fights scattered around here and there. These fights are generally not too exciting. You're normally just punching a guy and trying to evade his attacks. Some bosses will utter a couple lines of text before they die. Occasionally we'll get something like this, a maze-type indoor sequence. You know, at first I thought you had to jump over these rocks, but turns out you can actually kick them to stop them. There's also shinobi-like crates that you will use to move from floor to floor. The various traps here alternate between being really stupid and really irritating. At the very end, you'll find this guy whose entire body is encased in a block of concrete. Now the problem here, of course, is this sort of thing might make perfect sense to a fan of Fist of the North Star, but for kids playing this back in 1989, this becomes just complete nonsense. You have a power meter along the bottom that slowly builds up as you murder people. Once it reaches that first little arrow, you will suddenly hulk out. You know, your shirt will rip off, and your punches and kicks get all crazy. But there's still no exploding heads, right? I mean, if you remember the old Famicom Fist of the North Star game, the first one that was so very terrible, you'll recall that the main appeal was the ridiculously gory deaths. Well, in the Japanese version, yep, blood aplenty. Sadly, all this was removed from the version that we received, which pretty much takes away any entertainment value. When you move on to the next area, or chapter, as the game calls it, you power down. In order to get bulked up again, you need to increase your power to the next mark on the power meter. And that's it. The rest of the game is pretty much just like what we've already seen. Now obviously, this is pretty terrible, and it's a shame Sega didn't do anything interesting with the Fist of the North Star franchise here. Instead, they stuck to the formula established by the previous three terrible games, and made an incredibly dull beat-em-up. Alright folks, we've seen some impressive stuff from the very best minds at Sega today. Now it's time to jump into the kiddie pool. World Cup Soccer, or World Championship Soccer as it was called in the US. The title screen, either way, just says, quote unquote, soccer. Now unlike all the other sports games for the Mega Drive we've seen so far, Sega couldn't seem to find a reason to actually license the name of a famous soccer player for the US version, though many, maybe all the names here, are names of real-life soccer players. Though I guess since no likenesses are used, and really nothing beyond a last name is used, we can safely assume this was done without permission. I hope you like this brief musical loop here, since you're going to be hearing it constantly throughout the game. So, this game is super, super simple. There's two different buttons. There's like a high pass and a low pass button. The other button tackles. The character selection is automatic, which means, especially when the other team has the ball, you'll be unexpectedly bouncing around from player to player constantly, making for some confusion. I don't really care for this whole, like, automatic player selection system, but it was used in a lot of early sports games for the consoles. Now, the top-down view isn't particularly attractive, and I don't know why Sega went with this style, but I assume it allowed them to reuse some of the assets or the game engine or something from Tommy Lasorda's baseball, thus bringing down the costs. While mostly forgotten, in the US at least, it seems this game had a much higher profile in Europe when it was released there in 1990 under the name Italia 90. The title screen uses the official logo and a picture of Chow, the 1990 World Cup mascot, so I assume this is actually an official licensed World Cup product. And then there's a title screen credit to Olivetti, which is an Italian computer company, as well as Virgin Mastertronic. Did Sega license some rights from them? I mean, the game was ported to many computer systems in Europe, such as the Commodore 64 and the ZX Spectrum, and these versions were apparently very successful, but these were all published by Elite, not Virgin. So I'm really not sure what's up with these various copyrights to Olivetti or Virgin, or what they had to do with the game, if anything. Either way, it's a very simple soccer game, and probably really not going to interest you. Moving straight into August, we have the Mega Drive's first game based on a non-Sega arcade title. In this case, Capcom's Dai Makaimura. This was ported by Sega and published by Sega. Once again, we have the options screen. You can configure the button layout, change the difficulty, and so on. Outside of Japan, we know this as Ghouls and Ghosts, this being a sequel to Capcom's pioneering side-scrolling platformer, Ghosts and Goblins. Ghouls takes the basic formula of the first game and adds a few twists. It does, however, retain the insane difficulty of the first game. Now, the arcade game was pretty new at the time, having come out, I think, around December 1988, less than a year before the Mega Drive version. This pretty nifty intro unfortunately didn't make it onto the home version, I'm guessing for reasons of space. So we see Arthur ran off for 3 years to do something, who knows, king stuff? And then when he comes back, the forces of evil are destroying his town and kidnapping his lady friend. The arcade Ghouls and Ghosts is a gorgeous game. It takes the art style of Ghosts and Goblins and adds much more detail and color and throws in some great multi-layered backgrounds. The Mega Drive version doesn't look quite as good, but... oh, goddamn, that stupid vampire. He turns you into a duck. The treasure chests often contain harmful items as well as helpful items. Now, the main new feature here is actually magic. The magic armor is found in this chest, and putting it on makes a magic gauge appear, down in the lower left corner. You have infinite uses of magic, but they take a minute to charge. The bosses tend to be these large, impressive multi-sprite creatures. There's one at the end of each level. Ghouls and Ghosts throws in some environmental hazards as well as regular enemies. In fact, it usually combines these in a rather sadistic fashion, which is part of what makes Ghouls and Ghosts so damn difficult. Not to mention, of course, the fact that you can only take 2 hits before dying. Here's this dude returning from the first game, who would eventually get his own series on Nintendo's various platforms. There's a mere 5 levels in this game, each one separated by that great rolling map screen of the game's world. Level 3 is the one where the difficulty kicks up quite a bit. It's one of those damned forced scrolling levels, and there are various places where you can either crushed or killed in some horrible fashion if you don't move quickly enough. And don't even get me started on this part. Aside from avoiding enemies or falling to your death, those gargoyle heads will kill you if you touch them. Now, I've got the axe here. At various points, alternate weapons will be dropped, each with its own sort of speed, power, and range, just like in the Castlevania games. The axe naturally gets tossed in an arc, making it useful for destroying guys above you or below you, like this boss. As I mentioned earlier, Ghouls and Ghosts was a pretty popular arcade game from Capcom. This is not the first third-party game on the Mega Drive, but Capcom was a major player in the game world, much more so than SystemSoft or Technosoft, who had earlier put out Mega Drive games. And you'll notice we haven't covered this game in Crontendo, and we never will. Yep, this game skipped Nintendo's console entirely, though a sequel, Super Ghouls and Ghosts, turned up in 1991. But the fact that Capcom was on board this early into the console's lifespan is very promising, and the lack of third-party support was one major issue with the Master System. And here Capcom is, you know, basically going to take this very popular arcade game and hand it over to Sega rather than Nintendo. That's one sign of Nintendo's sort of console dominance not being quite as complete as it once was. The final level is sort of a greatest hits of enemies from the earlier levels, and I think from the earlier game as well. Various bosses reappear, sort of as mini bosses, including this guy, who was the final boss, Satan, in the first game, Ghosts and Goblins. The main bad guy here is Lucifer, who I guess is a different guy than Satan, though in the US version his name was changed to Loki. So after defeating the last mini boss, a giant fly, you enter one last door, and of course, Ghouls and Ghosts pulls the same huge screw you as in the first game. Yep, it sends you all the way back to the village at the very beginning. No problem, you just need to beat the game a second time. In the chest that originally held the magic armor, you now find a special magic weapon, the Psycho Cannon, assuming of course that you have the magic armor on. Now, this magic weapon is pretty powerful, so it might make certain sections a bit easier, but I mean, just damn, playing the entire game back to back is really not what you want to do at this point. There's no way this will ever feel like anything other but than just artificially padding the length. I wouldn't say this ruins Ghouls and Ghosts, but it's a cheap dick move, and you have to keep that magic weapon for the entire second run. If you lose it, like by accidentally touching another weapon, then you have to go through the whole thing again. For example, right here, this sword was dropped right at the foot of this ladder, preventing me from going forward without picking up the sword. though eventually I backtracked a bit, and then the sword finally disappeared, but, you know, it's difficult to avoid touching the sword if it's right there. Isn't it weird how his helmet disappears for a second here? Once you get to the end, you'll face Loki, or Lucifer. It's pretty obvious that he's the devil and not the Norse god. And in a sort of a perverse twist, he's really not that hard. His shots are relatively easy to dodge, and if you have the magic armor, you don't even have to jump to hit him. The bird then drops off the limp body of your girlfriend, and her spirit enters it. I guess killing the devil freed her from hell or something? Did every other dead person from the world come back to life too? Don't know. And the game, at the very end, the game explains the plot, which is, of course, a little late. So overall, a pretty damn good port of a flawed classic. I mean, it looks so good that it actually feels almost just like the arcade game unless you compare them back to back. I mean, the graphics and music take a bit of a hit, obviously, but it's still very impressive. And this version has unlimited continues, making it actually possible to beat. So really, this is a major milepost in the Mega Drive's history. Here we have Super Hang-On, which was released in October in Japan, and possibly a little bit earlier in the US. Now, I'm not saying this was rushed, but notice there's no music during the title screen. Usually that's a sign of something. There's two modes here, pretty typical for any sports-type games. Let's check out the arcade mode first. Four difficulty levels to choose from: beginner, junior, senior, and what are these, high school classes? And expert. Australia is like half the size of Africa on that map. You get to choose your music, OutRun style. Hey guys, where are you going? Well, what can we say about Super Hang-On? It's the third port from one of Sega's Super Scalar arcade games, after, of course, Super Thunderblade and Space Harrier 2. You drive around and, of course, try not to crash. Let's take a second to compare this to the arcade game. Exact same title screen, same for the music select screen and the world map. Super Hang-On came out in 1987, when it was, of course, the sequel to just regular old Hang-On, which was the first Super Scalar game from our good buddy Yu Suzuki and Sega's AM2. Super Hang-On wasn't really that much different from the first game, but let's compare this with the Mega Drive version. The motorcycle sprite is actually pretty much identical. The main difference is the colors, with the guy in the Mega Drive version sporting more primary colors than his arcade counterpart's more subdued palette. The backgrounds and various objects you pass along the side aren't quite as pretty, and it's a little bit choppier, but still, compared to, say, the Thunderblade port for the Genesis, it's pretty darn accurate. Just for kicks, let's take a look at the Master System port of Hang-On, which was a launch title in Japan. It's funny, when I covered this in the very first Cron Sega episode, I compared it to the NES stuff in 1985, and this seemed so amazing. Yet a mere 4 years later, looking at this and Super Hang-On is basically 8-bit versus 16-bit in a nutshell. Now the original mode is what you might call like a career mode or something. As was the style, in the career mode you win cash and use it to upgrade your bike by purchasing consistently better parts. You can also hire better mechanics and get better sponsors who will give you more money. And of course you actually earn money by racing. The basic bike you start off with is pretty crappy. It's very unresponsive when turning. There's a delay between pressing the D-pad and your bike actually responding. All the other bikes go way faster than you. It's really a pain to drive this thing. The sponsor gives you money, of course, just for finishing a race, because you can't really win races at this point. But your sponsor also pays you for even for losing, so you can buy basic upgrades and begin your slow ascent into the racing championship. Now, if you crash your bike too much, it will actually break. And the weird thing is, you can still enter a race with a broken bike, but you'll automatically lose, or quote-unquote retire, as the game calls it. And you do get paid a nominal fee for retiring. In fact, Early in the game, if you crash your bike and then keep entering races with your broken bike, you will make money faster than actually racing in a race. So no one ever said, you know, of course, that you know what happens in video games makes sense, but this is a good way to earn some money early on. So is Super Hang-On any fun? It's just a regular old racing game. Courses are long, kind of repetitive. The later courses look better than the rather boring first course, so I guess this is reasonably well made. We've reached August 1989, which, as some of you might know, marks the birth of the Sega Genesis in the United States. Yep, Sega of America launched the Genesis in New York and Los Angeles on August 14th. Now, at this time, Sega of America was apparently pretty small, with around only 50 employees. As you might recall, they had Tonka, the toy company, doing the marketing for the Master System for a while, and actually approached Atari about handling the Mega Drive in the US. Sega, of course, ended up handling the Genesis themselves, branding it with a big ol' 16-bit on the top. In October, it was launched nationally, and at that same month, Sega hired Michael Katz, formerly of Coleco, Epix, and Atari. Katz more or less got the Genesis off the ground, though he was eventually replaced by Tom Kalinske in 1991. The Genesis came with Altered Beast included, and another five titles were available at launch. There was Space Harrier 2, Super Thunderblade, Tommy the Sword of Baseball, Thunder Force, and Last Battle. Yep, they actually went with Last Battle as a launch title. Looking at game magazines from the time, I don't really see that much hype for the Genesis. Game coverage in these things is still about 95% Nintendo at this point. But Sega did launch this ad campaign. We see some, at this time, yet unreleased titles, like Forgotten Worlds and Holofighter? Yeah, that's actually Super Hydlide. Apparently they considered going with that name for a while. But there are some interesting pieces of hardware in this ad. One of them is, of course, the power base converter, which is the same thing as the Mega adapter in Japan. It just plugged into the cartridge slot and allowed you to play Master System games. A nice example of backwards compatibility on a console. But check this out. It was referred to in the text as the Telegenesis Modem, a planned and often delayed peripheral which actually never came out in the US. It was eventually released in Japan in late 1990. The modem allowed Japanese Mega Drive owners to connect to the Sega MegaNet. There were a number of MegaNet exclusive games available, the most famous of which was the Phantasy Star text adventure games. We eventually got the Sega Channel here instead. The TurboGrafx-16 launched almost exactly the same time as the Genesis in the US, and perhaps stole a bit of its thunder. Obviously, the Genesis beat out NEC's console eventually, but it will be a couple of years before Sega really saw much success over here. There's just one game released in September, and it's a frickin' golf game. Naomichi Ozaki knows Super Masters. If I'm not mistaken, this is only the second golf game released in Japan that features the likeness of a real-life player. The first, of course, being the Jumbo Ozaki Famicom game. And weirdly enough, Naomichi Ozaki is Jumbo's brother. So I guess you could say those Ozaki boys have the golf video game market locked down in Japan. Naturally, Sega needed a golf game for the Genesis in the US, you know, so your dad would have something to play. It was released here as Arnold Palmer Tournament Golf, keeping in line with Sega's other sports games, most of which use a big-name figure in the title. Arnold Palmer's pro golfing days were well in the past by 1989. He won all the major tournaments back in the 60s. But along with Jack Nicklaus, he was probably the most recognizable living pro golfer prior to Tiger Woods' rise to fame in the mid-90s. So anyway, about this game. Well, you know, it's a golfing game. You have clubs to choose from, you have a power meter, you can adjust your stance in various ways. All real exciting stuff. Maybe too exciting. I'm not sure my heart can take it. But, you know, I guess it looks nice. If we don't count the PC Engine as 16-bit, then this is the first 16-bit console golf game. A major milestone, really. Sega did add a couple nice little features though. Opa Opa makes an appearance in the game, and if you screw up really badly on a course, as in if you hit the ball 100 times without reaching the green, you'll get this little Fantasy Zone themed minigame. Unfortunately, it's not really Fantasy Zone, it's just a single screen where you sort of try to shoot some guys. But still, it's a nice touch. So is Arnold Palmer Tournament Golf any good? Well, it's pretty much just like every other golf game as far as I can tell, with slightly nicer graphics. Okay, fantastic intro there, and this is Super Shinobi, or Revenge of Shinobi as was called in the West. Sega was promoting the power of the Mega Drive by prefixing Super onto the titles of games much earlier than Nintendo did. Last episode we had Super Thunderblade, Super Daisen Yaku, and so on. As far as I can tell, Revenge of Shinobi was one of several games that came out in the US first before Japan. It was released in Japan in December, and it came out in the US sometime in 1989. Some sources give the date of June, which is obviously impossible, and other sources give the same date, December 2nd, as the Japanese release, which seems pretty unlikely. Seems there was a whole batch of games released in the US sometime in October. Of course, all this is kind of speculative. Shinobi is, of course, the sequel to the arcade classic, which has a Master System port, which came out in mid-1988. We covered it back in Chron Sega 6. Now here, Zeed, the criminal organization from the first game, has been reborn, and once again, the world is swallowed in darkness, which is a little dramatic there. Also, all Joe Musashi's ninja buddies were killed, and his fiancée kidnapped. So it is time for his titular revenge. Sega has included an options screen here, which is becoming an increasingly common thing on the Mega Drive. It allows you to change the control scheme, the difficulty, and also, you can cheat. There is a hidden cheat to get infinite number of shurikens, because I for one would not be able to tolerate this game without that cheat. Super Shinobi functions very similar to the first game. You walk from left to right, killing guys who come along. At a distance, you can throw your shurikens, and up close, use a melee attack. This is all done automatically. You only have one attack button. And there's lots of crates full of shuriken refills, power-ups, and bombs, which will hurt you if you're standing next to them when they explode. This is actually one of two Shinobi games to come out in 1989. In the 1989 arcade roundup from Crontendo 48, we encountered the oddly named Shadow Dancer, which is a completely different game from this one. But the fact that Sega created a sequel specifically for the Mega Drive indicates just how seriously they were now taking their position as a console maker. So here's the first boss. As in the first game, you have Ninja Magic, which you select from the pause menu. You can pick up magic refills here and there, normally found in crates. I'll use the fire magic on this dude, which does heavy damage, and then I'll spam him using this jump attack, which allows you to throw a whole bunch of shurikens in a wide downward spread. After each level, it'll show you moving forward on the map, which I think the first Shinobi game had a similar in-between level map like this as well. Now, the key to Shinobi is the jump. You have a double jump, which allows you to jump higher. Pressing the attack button while double jumping performs that multiple shuriken attack I mentioned earlier. The thing about the double jump is it's a little tricky to pull off. I mean, it gets easier with practice, of course, but it's still pretty finicky. Sometimes it's tempting to quote-unquote cheat by using ninja magic that gives you a better jumping powers, but of course that uses up a magic charge, and those come in handy later. As far as the plot goes, Super Shinobi doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. Your goal is simply to travel to the main bad guy's location and rescue your girlfriend, but the levels aren't really connected in any sort of comprehensible or logical way. And I was crossing some waterfalls a moment ago, and suddenly I appear in the city. You then fight a ninja in a disco. Still, this is pretty cool visually. In fact, I'd say that Super Shinobi is the first game that really kind of acts as a showcase for the Mega Drive's visual capabilities, compared to, say, the Alex Kidd game, which didn't really bring anything new to the Alex Kidd series. Super Shinobi sort of feels like a legitimate next-generation action game. This level is actually pretty clever. Using the double jump, you can jump from one side of the fence to the other, which is sort of like dividing the screen into a foreground and a background. And only enemies on the same side as you can hurt you, and vice versa. It's a neat effect, but it's actually kind of hard to see which side the projectiles are on when they're headed in your direction. Or this level, where you can get sucked out of the plane if you pass by an open door. Also, kind of an interesting idea. Now, for a relatively early title, it was pretty darned impressive. It's almost comparable to the kind of things you were seeing in arcades. One very noticeable characteristic of this game is the way that it sort of obviously threw in these unauthorized appearances of various characters. Here's Rambo, for example. And then this muscular dude gets greener and greener as you attack him, perhaps a reference to the Hulk, though when you finally kill him, it turns out he's sort of like a Terminator-like robot. Now, while this does have great visuals and music, there are a number of things I don't like about it. For example, it relies way too heavily on enemies hiding off-screen and throwing projectiles at you. Almost every enemy has a ranged attack, and they almost always start firing before they actually become visible, off the edge of the screen. You will often encounter guys with guns or grenades or even cars driving to run you down in this level here. But you spend a lot of time sort of, throwing shurikens, not at enemies that you can see, but at those which you think might be hidden just off-screen. Now, the double jump is probably what really drives most people over the bend in this game. It really is difficult to pull off with 100% consistency. There is a tiny margin of error for hitting the jump button a second time, right before you reach the apex of your jump. And in some cases, your character goes off the top of the screen when you jump, so you sort of have to guess as to what the right time is for the second jump. And aside from all this other stuff, if you throw in the fact that Joe Musashi is large, slow, and not very agile, actually not very ninja-like, then you've got a recipe for a pretty hard game, and one that has a lot of deaths that seem kind of unfair. You also get sent back to the beginning of each level when you die. So it's really all about practice and memorizing so that you're well prepared to deal with every enemy that suddenly pops up out of nowhere and attacks you. Alright, so going back to those that unauthorized appearances of famous characters which I mentioned earlier, in this boss fight we get both Spider-Man and Batman, and on the level after this, we end up with a boss fight against Godzilla, as absurd as that sounds. I mean, a ninja fighting Godzilla doesn't really sound that fair, but, he's kind of a wuss here. Now, eventually, these characters ended up being altered in appearance, probably to avoid legal troubles, except for Spider-Man, who actually officially became Spider-Man once Sega obtained the rights to make Spider-Man games. There's about 4 different versions of this ROM floating around, and all have different variations as to the appearances of these bosses. Now, the final area is, of course, a Super Mario Brothers-inspired maze castle thing. Only, it's pretty damned huge, and it'll take a long time to figure out how to actually get through it. I mean, really, are these mazes a good way to end a video game? I don't know. At the end, of course, you'll fight Zeed, who, of course, is some sort of kabuki demon guy who attacks you with his hair. And he also has constructed this enormous death trap for your girlfriend, which involves a slowly descending ceiling. And if you take too long to kill Zeed, she will get crushed, giving you the bad ending, where you, have emerged victorious, but at what cost? Now the key, I thought, was to have 3 magic charges with you when you're near the end, since you're very close to this exit as a power-up. The thing with the power-ups are is they make your weapon much stronger, but the power-up disappears if you take even one hit. So in other words, what you should do here is you should get this power-up and then use invincibility magic to make it to the level's end, since that final stretch is pretty much impossible to avoid without taking a hit. However, I found out after I completed the game there is a hidden power-up right before you fight the boss, so you could lose your power-up and then get another one and then do the boss fight. Either way, when the boss fight starts, you're going to want to have a power-up and 2 magic charges. So you use the invulnerability magic twice so you can take extra hits without losing your power-up. And this should give you enough time to take down Zeed and get the good ending, which isn't really that different, actually. Thank you. Anyway, technically speaking, a very nice looking game. Great music by the legendary Yuzo Koshiro. Whether or not you actually enjoy playing this thing is another matter. Some people love it to death, you may despise it. Okay, here's another one of the titles that were a very early Genesis release in the US and may have come out a little bit in the US before they did in Japan. This is, of course, Golden Axe. So first of all, that music is pretty sweet. Golden Axe has this attract screen type thing at the beginning, which sort of belies its arcade roots. It shows you who the three playable characters are and gives you a microscopic amount of backstory. Axe Battler is this guy's name, despite him carrying a sword as his weapon. His mother was killed by Death Adder. So sad. Right, so there's a few options here. Arcade is the standard mode for one or two players. Beginner is a shorter version of the game, sort of like a training mode. It only has the first few levels. Duel is interesting, kind of like an early version of a challenge mode in the one-player version. It requires you to fight 15 consecutive battles against groups of various enemies from the game. In the two-player version, it simply becomes a player versus player battle. Options let you choose control schemes, listen to the music. I'll raise my life bar to 5 since I'm terrible at Golden Axe. You then choose your character and get started. Golden Axe is a classic beat-em-up in the style of Final Fight. You have the balanced character, the strong character, and in this case, a character with powerful magic. I'll go for the dwarf, simply because, well, I mean, he's got the axe, right? So really, this works just like about every other beat-em-up of the late 80s, early 90s. The screen sort of freezes in place while a group of enemies come out, between 2 and 4 at a time. Once you kill the group, you can then start moving forward again, then another group will appear, and so on. There's only one attack button, but when you start wailing on a foe, you will have the option to pick them up and throw them, or sort of hit them on the head with your axe, and you also have a powerful jump attack that knocks foes down, and perhaps best of all is a dash attack, which knocks them down and pushes them back a bit. Enemies tend to rely a lot on dash attacks, and it does actually feel a little overpowered, and can be used pretty much to spam most bosses to death. Golden Axe, the arcade game, was apparently released around June of 1989, which means it came to the consoles very quickly. We just covered Golden Axe in the 1989 arcade roundup Last Crontendo, but we'll take a closer look at it now today. It was created by Makoto Uchida, who is also responsible for Altered Beast, Alien Storm, and the Die Hard arcade game. Inspired rather obviously by movies like Conan, the idea was to create a beat-em-up that didn't use the typical street gang subject matter like so many other games did. A few things we'll notice: the digitized voice samples, apparently including David Caruso from First Blood, according to Hardcore Gaming 101. Also notice the bodies don't disappear after you kill someone, which was unusual at the time. Golden Axe is pretty short, you can burn through the thing pretty damn quickly on a few quarters without too much effort. For the Genesis version, a few things had to be dropped. The slain enemies now blink for a second and disappear, in a more standard video game fashion. The sampled death screams have now been replaced with a pretty horrible generic synthesized shriek. But for the most part, the game is a pretty accurate port. The character sprites are almost identical to the arcade version. The backgrounds have been simplified and the colors are different, but overall this is a big improvement over the port of Altered Beast. Now, Golden Axe, like most beat-ups, is a very simple game. You fight some enemies, move forward a screen or two, fight some more. Occasionally, you'll fight some tougher enemies. Then the level ends. 7 levels in total. Now, between these levels, these little elves with knapsacks will come out. You can smack them around, and they'll drop you some magic potions. Or occasionally, a big ham bone or something that refills your health a bit. Elves, or thieves, as the game actually calls them, also sometimes appear in the middle of the level. Now this always happens at set points, and they will always drop a set number of potions, so the maximum number of potions you can pick up during the game is always going to be the same. The potions are used to cast magic, and doing so will use up all your potions at once. I'm at level 3 magic, as you can see by looking at the gauge at the top. All the magic does is simply damages all on-screen enemies at once, but the other characters have more magic levels and thus can do more damage when they cast a magic spell, though this requires them to collect more potions and they can use their magic spells less. The dwarf has the weakest magic. It can't even finish off these three unremarkable enemies. Other interesting things you can do, occasionally rideable creatures will appear. If you smack off the rider, it'll allow you to jump on and then you can cause all sorts of havoc. These rideable creatures are like the golden axe's equivalent of the lead pipes and knives you can pick up off the ground found in other beat-em-ups. Back in the Crontendo 1989 arcade roundup, I called Golden Axe, along with Final Fight, one of the games that sort of inaugurated the era of classic beat-em-ups, and it holds up pretty well to this day. It's briskly paced, there's a wide variety of settings and enemies, it doesn't reach the heights of insanity the way some of the later beat-em-ups did, but it's still pretty enjoyable. One thing I mentioned earlier is that the dash attack can be spammed against pretty much every enemy and boss. You can go through the whole game just dash attacking everyone to death, though enemies will use it against you a lot as well. The arcade game only had 5 levels, and this boss battle against Death Adder and 2 skeletons was the final confrontation in the game. Quite frankly, the skeletons give you more hassle than Death Adder himself. Once the skeletons are gone, you can simply repeatedly dash attack him or jump attack him until he dies. Then the king and princess of the kingdom get lower down. They're strung up on chains, and they give you a thank you. Now, the arcade version ended here, and then we got this absolute nutso ending where we were transported inside a Sega arcade, where suddenly all the monsters from the Golden Axe game start popping out of the cabinet and terrorizing the place and chasing people through the streets. Altered Beast had a similar ending where we saw the characters take off their masks and whatnot and revealed that all the characters were just actors. The Genesis version of Golden Axe dispenses with that ending, and instead, the king tells you that he thinks Death Adder was actually taking orders from someone else. Then the game adds on another 2 levels. Do you guys remember the Master System Shinobi? There was that one awful jump right in the middle of the game for no reason. They put in one really difficult jump in a game which otherwise had pretty much no difficult jumps at all. The Genesis Golden Axe does that exact same thing right here. And you know, it doesn't look that bad and often looks like you're going to make it, and then you just sort of fall right through and die. It's actually quite ridiculous. Anywho, once you reach the 7th level, you'll fight the real boss, who goes by the name of Deathbringer, who I suppose is Death Adder's older brother or something. This dude can actually use all the magic attacks of the playable characters, but he only does so after he gets a hit on you with his axe, so avoid letting him hit you. In the arcade game, it feels like Death Adder is closer in difficulty to this guy, and that the Genesis Death Adder was sort of made a bit easier. So basically just keep moving around and pummeling this guy with dash attacks and jump attacks, and eventually he'll end up getting bisected by his own axe. The blood from the arcade version's death scene has been removed here. Then the king thanks you and gives you the title of Grandmaster. And he calls out to the champions of the realm to prepare a grand feast. But who are you talking to, you old fool? It's just the 3 of us down here in the dungeon. It's sad, really. I don't even know how we're gonna get out of here. I mean, this guy doesn't even look like he can stand up. We've gotta jump across that bottomless pit again? The credits show all the game's enemies and their stats, including their weights and something called attack and move level. By the way, a few of these guys have beer-related names, like Malt, Hop, and Bitter. Chicken Leg is one of the beasts that you can ride in this game. As you recall, he was an altered beast as well. And then finally we get a silly sequence that shows you the real credits, though of course everyone uses these absurd nicknames. So Golden Axe is definitely the best port of one of Sega's own arcade games on the Genesis so far, and I think it's going to hold that record for at least a little while. We now move into October with a rather contentious game, Super Hydlide. Before we get any further, let's enjoy this rather wicked music during the intro. You may have noticed the credits during the title screen: T&D Soft, creators of the original computer game, and Seismic, the company that released this in the US. The Japanese version was published by Asmic Ace, who are part of the Ask Kodansha media conglomerate. This is the second game released by Asmic Ace, the first being a licensed Famicom game based on the manga Gambler Jiko Chūshinha. Man, we just get some fantastic synthesized guitar parts here. Now Seismic, the American company that released this, is a bit more mysterious than Asmic. I don't really know much about them. They were based in Santa Clara, home of Intel, National Semiconductor, Nvidia, you know, right in the heart of Silicon Valley. They released about 5 games total, all on Sega platforms, and all were games released overseas by other publishers. As we saw earlier, this was advertised by Sega under the name HoloFighter, and this is the first third-party published game to be released for the Genesis in the US. Okay, so I'm making my character here. There's 4 classes to choose from. I'll go with Priest, who has some pretty decent stats for the beginning of the game. And your actual stats are determined by virtual dice rolls, so you can sort of keep rolling if you want to get slightly better stats. You start off in a village, which already sort of sets this apart from the original Hydlide, in which you were literally the only person in the entire game world. There were no NPCs or villages or anything like that. Super Hydlide, on the other hand, is a clearly a post-Dragon Quest JRPG, though in most ways it's actually a bit clunkier than your big-name late 80s RPGs from Square or Enix, and in all fairness, this game was actually a couple years old in 1989. The original version came out in 1987 on the MSX, and was subtitled The Space Memories. The first console port was for the Famicom, released in Japan in February 1989. I didn't really talk that much about this version in Crontendo, since I knew we'd be covering the same game here. Super Hydlide looks marginally nicer than the computer version, but is still not a game that's very easy on the eyes. In the village you can buy supplies, such as food, weapons, armor, and spells. Spells, however, are only purchased in a very specific linear order, and are actually bought using experience rather than cash. There's also an inn, which is pretty expensive at 1,000 gold per night. Super Hydlide does have a few unusual mechanics, at least unusual for JRPGs of this time. One of them is weight. Yep, just like Elder Scrolls or whatever, everything, including gold, has a weight. And if the weight of what you're carrying exceeds your capabilities, you'll start moving super, super slow. Thankfully, your max carry weight increases as you level up. However, I can't even carry a lousy slingshot at this point. Luckily, there is a ridiculous cheat built in. See, finding money also grants you experience, and in this particular spot, you can drop a coin and then pick it up for experience. If you do this over and over again, you'll actually keep building up experience much faster than if you were to actually go around and start killing monsters. So once you have enough EXP, trudge on over to this building here, and you can raise your level. Just like the Ultima games, you actually have to talk to this dude in order to level up. It doesn't happen automatically when you get enough experience points. The Hydlide games are action RPGs, sort of like the Ys series. The slingshot I have is a ranged weapon useful for priests, who aren't very strong. Killing enemies will drop EXP and money. However, there is yet another unusual feature here, morality. Some creatures will not attack you, like those green plant things. Killing them will actually cause your morality level to drop, eventually resulting in traps appearing everywhere on the world. The main overworld, at least what we see this early in the game, isn't really that interesting, nor is it that easy to find your way around, since so many screens on the map look almost identical. This uses the flip screen style instead of smoothly scrolling, just like the original computer game. Exploring around, you'll find a dungeon, a hidden town, and this little cave where you can pick up, in a completely unmarked spot, 10,000 gold. Yet another non-standard JRPG mechanic is hunger. You need to eat twice a day, or you'll start losing health and getting weaker. And since the stores are closed at night, you can't actually buy any bread once it gets dark. So it is possible to die not from enemies, but from hunger. The rather expensive inn is your only option if you run out of food at night. As a result of all these unfamiliar mechanics, the game feels quite strange. The ending is pretty wild too. I'll describe it to you since I didn't actually play it to the end. Highlight 3 is one of those games where the final boss is God. Near the end of the game, sci-fi elements are thrown in and you enter a spaceship. Once you destroy the last boss, he tells you that he is the creator of the universe and that he created humanity too much in his own image, thus leading to his own defeat. Once you kill him, he actually simply goes away, but this causes the universe to die, with the protagonist being the last person left alive, sort of floating out in the void. He then somehow recreates the world himself. A rather bizarre ending. And just like Hydlight wasn't really a terrible game, but instead simply a pre-Dragon Quest computer RP that didn't really translate very well onto the NES, so is Super Hydlight an interesting game that just isn't very pleasing aesthetically. One last thing, it's interesting to note that Hydlight didn't get released in the US on the Nintendo Entertainment System until June 1989, 4 months before Super Hydlight's original Japanese release. Now granted, Super Hydlight didn't come out in the US until early 1990, but still, Hydlight's super belated US release is one reason why that game seemed so awful. It was a virtual relic by the time we saw it here in the US. So I guess in conclusion, interesting game, don't know if you will actually like playing it, it's kind of tedious, but it's certainly worth looking into. Our second game, and the final game from October, is Rambo 3. There's a nice digitized photo of Rambo about to shoot you in the face with an arrow. Now the Genesis is able to display semi-decent digitized photos, thus avoiding the horrible character artwork we saw in the NES Rambo game. Carolco was the film production company that actually produced Rambo, as well as the Terminator movies, and actually, they had lots of huge 80s hits. Anyway, I actually like this intro. Once again, we have a well-stocked options screen, and the controller customization on the Genesis is becoming relatively common. And enjoy this nice little intro of what I assume is Troutman getting captured by this Soviet helicopter. Now, this is the second Rambo 3 game we've seen, and one of the many, many different Rambo 3 video games. You'll recall the Master System Rambo 3, which was a light gun game. We covered that a few episodes ago. There was also a sort of a similar Rambo 3 arcade game, and then there were some versions that turn up on the various computers. Now, if you've seen the movie Rambo 3, you know it takes place in Afghanistan, so I guess all these guys you're killing are Soviet Army dudes. The game doesn't really name names, however. Even in the manual, the only term used is enemy or soldier. No mention of the Soviet Union or anything like that, with the one exception being in that opening cutscene, the helicopter is referred to as being a Russian Hind. Obviously, Rambo 3 bears more than a passing resemblance to Mercs. It's sort of like a less exciting version of Mercs. Now between top-down scenes, you'll have these little sort of quick segments where you need to blow up a tank or a helicopter with an arrow. You can't move while charging your arrow, and a single hit will cause you to lose life, so these parts can be a little annoying. Most of the game alternates between straightforward levels, where you just sort of march forward killing dudes like the first level, and these maze-like levels, where you need to explore a bit more. Here you need to find 3 prisoners. The first two will always be the wrong guy. And the third one is a spy that has some intel for you. Then the alarm goes off, and you need to escape before it blows up. The game, of course, never clarifies why freeing this guy triggers some kind of self-destruct sequence in the prison, or why none of the guards are trying to escape the prison before it blows up. Now here's a bit about the controls. The first button fires your machine gun, and you also have 3 secondary weapons. Unfortunately, you select the weapon, the secondary weapon, by using the second button to sort of scroll through them, and then the third button you use to actually use the currently selected weapon. So when you're under heavy fire, it's a bit of a pain to be firing your machine gun while checking the left-hand side of the screen and scrolling through the choices with the second button. The Hardcore Gaming 101 article points out the dagger is useless, so why didn't they just assign the bombs to one button and arrows to the other one? This seems like a good idea, even though the knife isn't really useless. Killing enemies with a knife nets you more points, and it causes bombs and bow ammo to drop. Still, the control scheme is definitely a bit of a pain in the ass. Note that this pose that Stallone is doing, tying on the headband that happens before the shooting sections, is taken directly from the movie. Is Rambo 3 a bad game? I'd say no. I mean, it's decent for a relatively early Mega Drive game. It's not nearly as fun or chaotic as Mercs. I really didn't care that much for these mostly empty big maze levels, where you just sort of run around looking for something. In this case, it's enemy weapons. But there are a lot of pretty cool touches, like how you can clearly see the bow on Rambo's back as he runs around, or the lighting in this level. Look, for example, when you open these doors, you can see light coming through the opening. That's an unusual detail. Clearly, Sega put a lot of effort into this. I personally feel that it lacks the ineffable something that makes a game really fun to play 25 years later, but it's certainly no piece of licensed crap either. Alright, we enter the month of November 1989 with our last Mega Drive game today, Forgotten Worlds, and it's another Capcom arcade game, ported, presumably, by Sega. Looking at the options screen, there's an interesting one I don't think we've seen before, Auto Fire. We'll turn it on. You'll see why in a minute. Pretty rad intro here. Now, right away, I'll let you know that Forgotten Worlds is a game that you may not like due to the controls. First off, I'll point out this was a port of a 1988 arcade game.
Did you find the guy?
I'll finish you today for sure.
As we see, the Mega Drive captured the intro pretty well, minus the speech. Now, if this looks just totally bonkers to you, then you're very observant. It's actually difficult to emulate the controls of the game, since the original used a joystick and a rotary dial. The rotary dial controlled the direction that you fire in. Obviously, this particular mechanic never became common in shoot-em-ups, but Forgotten World was, at the very least, a nice-looking game. I don't know why exactly, but while the visuals on the Mega Drive version of Ghouls and Ghosts impress me, this port of Forgotten Worlds doesn't look quite as good. It's sort of blah looking. Oh, by the way, here's the shop. Forgotten Worlds, of course, throws in RPG elements. Enemies drop money or gems or something, and you spend them here on weapons upgrades, health refills, armor that lets you take a couple hits before you die, and an item that resurrects you after you lose all your health. The shop appears once in the middle of each level. I went for a weapon that fires in all directions because, quite honestly, I cannot deal with this crazy control scheme. The D-pad works normally, it moves your character up or down, left or right. One button fires, though, as I mentioned earlier, I'm using auto fire. The other two buttons rotate your weapon. Now, one moves it clockwise, the other counterclockwise. Though, of course, where the rotary knob lets you move around your weapon pretty precisely, I could not aim very well using the Mega Drive's buttons. Often, when I try to rotate my weapon around, I might hold down for a split second too long, and thus would be rotated too far. So I then need to press the other button, try to rotate it a tiny bit back, all the while you're still trying to move your ship around and avoid enemies. I actually found it's more trouble than it was worth, and for those of you with brains able to move around your character and your laser cannon in different directions simultaneously, you will probably be better at this game than I am. So Forgotten Worlds isn't exactly bad. I mean, some parts, like this giant boss, are pretty cool. But the whole concept of being able to rotate your weapons 360 degrees, it just did not translate well to the Genesis controller. Alright, to round out this episode, we'll take a look at five Master System games. Don't get too excited. These were seemingly released in fall 1989 or sometime in late 1989, based on references to them in video game magazines and advertisements. So, quite frankly, Sega was definitely not throwing huge amounts of money and talent at the Master System by this point. Wanted is a cheap and fast light gun game released in the US and Europe. Sega, like Nintendo, always pushed the light gun more in those territories than they did in Japan. Wanted is a little odd because it's a third-person perspective light gun game. You can see your character at the bottom of the screen, though I'm not really sure why. It doesn't seem to add anything to the game. If anything, it's a bit distracting. And Wanted really does not need more distractions than it already has. All the sprites are pretty darn small, and there's often quite a lot of them on the screen at once, and the guys that you aren't supposed to shoot look exactly like the guys you are supposed to shoot. The same outfits and everything, only they hold their hands up in the air. For some dumb reason, when you shoot the good guys, a miss word balloon appears, even though you obviously didn't miss them. In fact, you shot them. Shooting the wrong guys drains your health, as does, of course, getting shot. Shooting the barrels will reveal a giant cartoon-type bomb. Shooting that, of course, kills everyone on screen, but also refills your health. Wanted is an original game, and while there was an arcade game called Wanted a few years before this, it has no connection to this whatsoever as far as I can tell. The level ends with a boss of sorts who moves around really fast, and you know, he requires a lot of shots to kill. We then move on to one of two incredibly annoying levels in which the screen scrolls really fast and guys ride by on horses. It doesn't really look that bad, I guess, when you're watching the video, but when you're playing this, this is so irritating. It's really hard to see and hit all these guys, and the background is so distracting. And look, look at the way they put all those like little horizontal lines in the background, seeing those things fly by. I mean, it makes it look like you're moving, but it really does distract you quite a bit when you're trying to play it. There's only 6 levels total on this thing, and we've already seen about a third of the game in this very short segment, and beyond this, there's really not much to see, so I guess we'll just go ahead and wrap this up. Yay, another port of one of Epix's inexplicably popular sports games. This is, of course, World Games, originally released for the Commodore 64 in 1986. And this was, what, the third, fourth such game in the series? After Winter Games, Summer Games, California Games, Winter Games 2, I don't know, there were a whole lot of them. As far as I can tell, the Master System version was only released in Europe, sometime in 1989. Who knows when? Now this has already received an NES port in March 89, published by Milton Bradley and ported by Rare. We covered it back in Crontendo 43. The game covers some kinds of like off-the-wall sports that didn't fit into the other Epix games, like sumo wrestling and bull riding. Now just like all the other games in this series, we have a bunch of options. You can practice, play individual games, do the Olympic type thing where you go through all the events, and then get a final score at the end. Now here's the weird thing, despite the Master System being a console that had huge games, like Phantasy Star on it, the Master System World Game version actually cuts out half the events, from 8 down to 4. I mean, the NES World Games had all 8 games, but somehow only 4 could be fit onto this cart. Now, longtime viewers of Crontendo will know that I don't like this style of game. By which I mean, I like games with simple, intuitive control schemes, such as, you know, most of the games you play. However, games like this, or Skate or Die, are played using these inconsistent, arbitrary control schemes that result in them kind of being like, almost like little mini-rhythm games, except without any clear visual or musical cues. And that said, most of the events in this particular version of World Games all have a pretty simple control scheme. Three out of the four games involve rapidly alternating between pressing left and right on the controller. This is what we're doing here. You run just by hitting left, right, left, right, left, right, and then pressing the button to jump over the barrels. For me, it just wasn't working. I mean, even just wailing on the D-pad buttons, I couldn't get the power meter up very high. I must not have been pressing them like with the right rhythm or something like that. I don't know. Oh boy, the grand Canadian sport of log rolling. And it's actually the same thing here, you just alternate between left and right. Unlike barrel jumping, this doesn't really seem to require much effort, and I got a gold medal the first time I played it. Now, bull riding is a weird one. This is of course the classic rodeo sport, which became kind of mainstream in the early 80s due to the popularity of mechanical riding bulls, which kind of took off after one appearing in that movie, Urban Cowboy. You hang on to the bull by pressing down when the bull is spinning around, and then by hitting left or right when the bull is trying to buck you off. And again, there is some sort of mysterious timing involved, and I couldn't quite figure it out since I got bucked off the bull half the time, or and managed to stay on half the time, seemingly at random. The caber toss is one of those Scottish Highland game events where you're basically just throwing a big log. What else do they do at those Highland things? Or it's like hammer throwing or something? I'm not sure. Anyway, again, you do the left and right buttons, then throw the log. It's actually kind of the same game as the barrel jumping one, but it has to be at the correct angle, otherwise it'll either fall back onto you and land on your foot, or land on your head and then hammer you into the ground. As I mentioned, World Games doesn't seem to have come out in the US, though I think it was scheduled to be released around late 1989. It appeared in an ad in GamePro for this video game mail order company, and it even showed a price. You can see it right there above Ease. As you'll notice, cartridges were pretty damn expensive back then. I mean, look at the price on Ultima 4. That's a lot of money today. And that was actually even more outrageous in 1989 dollars. So anyway, this is almost the last Epic title I'll have to play. There is at least one more, an NES exclusive, California Games 2. And then I think we'll be done. First of all, I have no idea what the name Dead Angle is supposed to mean. And then there's this title screen, kinda weird for an action game, looks like some rich dude's house. But then Dead Angle is actually a pretty weird game. Seibu Kaihatsu is credited on the cover, they created the original arcade version of this, and they had also put out Empire City 1931, a very similar game which got a Famicom port that we covered some time ago in Crontendo. And they also did Dynamite Duke, which will get a Master System port at some point in the future. Now this is not a light gun game despite looking like one. You control your crosshairs with a D-pad. And just like most of these types of games, you're sort of wandering around the streets and alleys while tons of identical guys jump out and shoot at you. The unusual thing here is that you can duck. When an enemy has you in their sights, your outline turns red. This means that you are likely to get shot. Pressing the other button will cause you to duck, or rather, you sort of squat down a little bit. You can only duck for a moment though, and then you'll automatically stand back up and become a target again. Now, everything about this game seems a little off somehow. The gameplay feels very awkward and clumsy. However, checking out the original arcade game shows you that at heart, Dead Angle isn't really that bad of a game. As we see here, the graphics are much nicer. There are different layers of backgrounds and foreground. The bad guys can be hidden behind various objects. Dead Angle makes pretty decent use of the environments, like this ship here. It's actually a pretty appealing arcade shooter, even if it's not exactly a classic of the genre. Now by contrast, the Master System port just sort of feels like a failed arcade port, like the Arcade 2600 version of Pac-Man or something. Everything just feels kind of off somehow. Probably the main issue is that enemies now just sort of materialize in front of you instead of running in from the sides. As a result, you get shot way too frequently when someone just pops up directly in front of you and blam, out of nowhere. Here's the first boss. Basically, they're like your standard light gun game type bosses. They run back and forth and shoot at you, and they take a whole bunch of hits to kill. I was actually a little surprised at just how much I dislike this game. I mean, usually these types of shooting games are pretty harmless, but this one just annoyed the hell out of me. Aside from the sort of jerky motion when you move around, all the enemies and locations were just sort of stripped of any sort of personality. For example, when I first played this, I didn't catch that it was taking place at a port. Only when I played the arcade version and saw there was a ship, I realized what exactly this place was supposed to be. I mean, honestly, you'll never know it by looking at the backgrounds. They're just crates, staircases. This could be a warehouse, the back room of a department store, a bad guy's secret lair. Everything here is just so generic. So I can't completely explain my dislike for the home version of Dead Angle, other than it's just sort of an ugly, clumsy, unpleasant game. Alright, let's get this one little fact out of the way. The music and title screen are probably the slickest things about this game. The result of global warfare was global peace. That makes sense. Oh, and then the aliens invade. Well, at least we all know where the name comes from. Scramble Spirits is a vertical shoot-'em-up, which greatly resembles the games Toa Plan was making for Taito around this time, such as Tiger Heli and its various sequels. You fly over various cities, shooting enemy forces on the ground and in the air. And wait a second, Sega. I'm calling bullshit on this. I thought we were being invaded by aliens. These are clearly Earth planes and tanks I'm shooting at. And why would an alien invasion force build defensive turrets on all the roofs of Earth cities? So obviously the whole alien invasion thing was tacked on after the game was finished. And then you get these weird little segments. The first time I played this, I had no idea what was going on. It turns out these are like little minigame interludes where you simply try to rack up points. You can't take damage during the aircraft carrier sections even if you get hit. Though you do get a bonus if you can destroy all the tanks and planes. Just like Dead Angle, Scramble Spirits was originally an arcade game with much nicer looking graphics. And again, the graphical downgrade makes the Master System version a bit confusing. For example, I had no idea those ship things down there were supposed to be in the water when playing the console version. I thought they were just like weird futuristic looking spaceships or something. But playing the arcade game, now it all makes sense. Same with the aircraft carrier sections. In the Master System game, it looks like you're sort of like floating around in some abstract space because of the flat, gray background. But here, there's this great zoom-in effect, and it looks like you're actually attacking an aircraft carrier. All the objects in the arcade version of Scramble Spirits look solid and recognizable, but when the game got converted down to 8 bits, it lost a lot of its character. Now, Scramble Spirits actually gave me a few headaches while playing it at first. It's pretty hard to see the enemy projectiles with the garish background colors and the fact that there's quite a bit of flicker going on. It makes it pretty distracting. The majority of the time when I got hit, I had no idea that I was going to get hit by a projectile. I simply did not see it at all when it was coming towards me. Despite that, on my first try, I got reasonably far into the game before I ran out of lives and patience, specifically to the level 4 boss, and there's only 6 levels. So basically, the game is pretty easy if you can learn to overcome the hard-to-see enemy shots. I guess the game gets a little better after the first couple levels. And Scramble Spirits is certainly not the worst shoot-'em-up we've ever seen. I'd say it's a decent middle-of-the-road arcade shooter that received a seriously flawed port. I remember really hating this while I was actually playing it, but looking at the footage now, it doesn't really seem that bad. Okay, let's wrap this shit up with Dynamite Ducks. Not to be confused with Dynamite Duke, another game which we'll be covering eventually and which I briefly mentioned in the Dead Angle segment. Though you know, on this title there's an umlaut on the U, so it might actually be pronounced Dynamite Dukes. And holy shit, this is one ugly opening cutscene here. And those colors. The bad guy's name is apparently A-Cha-Cha. He transforms the dude into a duck named Ben, or maybe Bean. Ben needs to rescue his girlfriend, Lucy. So it's a pretty standard, absurd video game plot. And clearly, this is pretty painful on the eyes. Yet, the original arcade version looked much nicer. There was an option here of a two-player co-op, so there are two ducks instead of just one, and neither of them is a transformed human being. Note the cameo by Colonel Sanders here. He returns later in the game. Dynamite Duck stands out visually because of the unusual character design. Enemies are pretty darned weird, like this legless dog and these moose heads. They look sort of inspired by American cartoons from the 1940s, like Walter Lantz or something. Ben kind of resembles Woody Woodpecker a bit, but mostly it's just weird looking. Sadly, none of the arcade game's charm really transfers over to the Master System version. Whereas guys like Capcom and Konami knew how to alter a video game, an arcade game, to make it palatable on an 8-bit console, whoever ported this essentially attempted to do a pretty much straight conversion, with rather sad results. It reminds me a lot of Dead Angle, in that sense. I suppose Dynamite Ducks could be considered to be a beat-em-up of sorts, though enemies really only normally take about one or two hits to kill, and they don't really attack you, they just sort of march mindlessly in your direction. You have two attacks, a weak punch and a strong punch, which requires winding up. Again, a very cartoon-like feature. Better yet, you'll often find these limited-use projectile weapons, ranging from rocks to bazookas. Why look, here's a bazooka right now. And here's a fine example of the arcade game graphics totally failing to survive the transformation into 8-bit form. What are these little white things rushing at you? Now, they're supposed to be a group of mice. But here, they end up looking just like, sort of like little white blobs. This is the first boss, a giant ball of fire. You kill him with a super soaker type gun, and he shoots fireballs at you. Most of the bosses sort of resemble this. They're like some sort of anthropomorphic sphere of some type with eyes that surrounds itself with a protective layer of little clones. Here's the next boss, a rock that has a bunch of other rocks orbiting itself. One way to deal with this guy is to sort of stand still and wind up a punch and then try to hit the ring of rocks as it expands. Now one thing I'll point out, many of the enemies are strangely passive. They don't attack you so much as just kind of walk towards you, or actually just sort of walk down the street, getting in your way. I like to think that Ben is actually really just going the wrong way down a street where a parade is happening. But the point is, you can simply walk around most enemies and only really killing the ones who block your way. I think the fact that the enemies don't engage you is one of the reasons I dislike this. The enemies are just sort of there. The funny thing is, I was looking forward to Dynamite Ducks because of the goofy art style in the arcade game. I was kind of hoping it might be some kind of overlooked late period Master System gem, but in reality it's just an unpleasant looking repetitive mess. Alright, so we didn't exactly go out on a high note today. I don't know that the Master System selections are really going to get any better anytime soon, though. So, best game and worst game. For best, I'll say Golden Axe. But hey, you know, if you want to mentally swap in Revenge of Shinobi instead, then by all means, go ahead. I will not complain. Worst game? Geez, I don't know, really any of the Master System games would probably qualify today. However, I'll give the prize to World Games. I mean, I didn't like this game already, but for the Master System version, they only gave us half the game. And all four of the individual games that they put on the cart are all kind of similar in the way they use the controls. So this is probably the least worthwhile game in this episode, in my opinion. So next Cron Sega, we will reach January 1990. Yay! And there will be a few well-loved games coming up, so you'll have something to look forward to.